morning.
Good morning.
It is a pleasure and honor to be here, and I preached the first service, and I have to say, I don't remember ever receiving as warm a welcome as I received from Judd and Roger when I came in, because I got here a little late, and I think they tried to draw straws to see who was going to preach if I didn't make it. So they were quite happy that I did get here. I also am so appreciative of your pastor and my dear friend, Reverend Rizzola Law, for extending to me this invitation to be here. I was in the area for Jarvis Christian College's trustee meeting and their opening of their site in Dallas at the Red River Mall, and I was going to stay over the weekend, and Pastor Rizzola invited me to preach this morning. What she didn't tell me is that she wasn't going to be here. But I'm grateful to her, and she has just been such a dear friend and such a pastoral spirit. So I'm grateful. She did warn me. She said, you know, this is a very good community. It's a strong community. Everyone gets along, and don't say anything partisan or one way or the other. Stay pretty close to the middle. And so I have to confess, I'm a Longhorns fan. So much so that my golden retriever's name is Devo. Pastor Burton told me, he invited me if I wanted to come dressed in purple. I said, no, I've got a burnt orange robe. He said, no, we'll have none of that. But unfortunately, we didn't fare so well yesterday, but we'll just move on past. But thank you for hosting me, and thank you for such a warm reception this morning. The gospel lesson has been read from Luke chapter 17, verse 11 through 19, and I'd just like to lift out a small portion of that. They called out, saying, Jesus, have mercy on us. When he saw them, he said, go and show yourselves to the priests. And as they were made clean, then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice, and prostrated himself at Jesus' feet, and thanked him. If you would pray with me for just a few moments on the subject, sky priority. Let us pray. Gracious and eternal God, we come before you with thanksgiving in our heart. As the song says, there is a river whose streams make glad the spirit of our God. We acknowledge that Jesus Christ is our river. Jesus Christ is that stream, pouring out salvation on all of us. We drink from that stream freely and graciously. God, we thank you and we ask that you pour out on us your spirit in this place, that you will allow your spirit to anoint these words and make them your words. Let them be words of love, words of hope, words of liberation, words of righteousness for your name's sake. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. Sky priority. That is an interesting title, and some of you who have spent any time in an airport may recognize that phrase, sky priority. It comes from Delta Airlines. Now, I have to say that I travel a lot. Even in my current role, I travel quite a bit as president of Higher Education and Leadership Ministries. But I've always traveled throughout my career. Before I went into ministry, I was an executive sales, and I traveled quite a bit up and down the West Coast, sometimes two or three times a week. Even beyond that, when I was a fundraiser for a seminary, I would travel a lot, visiting donors and visiting churches. And now in my role, I travel visiting churches and visiting our disciples' institutions. One of the things that I know about traveling is that airlines have ways of providing benefits to people who spend the most with their airlines. If you buy a first class ticket or the new enhanced coach main cabin seats, you get more legroom and you perhaps get special drink options if you're into that sort of thing. This privilege even extends to the check-in and boarding process. If you are an elite traveler or you're traveling first class, you get to check in early. You get a dedicated check-in line at the airport. stick with me here, and we'll get through this. I happen to fly a lot on Delta, and I know that American, United, and all the airlines use the same approach of designating status to its most frequent flyers and netting out privileges based on that status. Traveling as much as I do, you recognize pretty quickly that the airline industry relies on loyalty and they give privileges to their most frequent flyers. First century Palestine, the area of Israel that we have our text from, is no different in the sense that privilege figures prominently in how people are treated and what kind of access they have. But that privilege is based on something different in the text. In fact, the privileges in first century Israel has more to do with things like geographical location. It has more to do with things like social location and gender and health status. And then when the Romans make their incursion into the area, the Romans establish citizenship as a priority. So this screams at us, this idea of privilege and special status speaks to us from this particular text, even though we don't necessarily recognize it readily. So allow me to illustrate how this idea of privilege and priority works itself out in the text. The first evidence we see is when it describes where the text happens. It happens in the region between Galilee and Samaria. Now, if you know anything about the geography of that region, you know that Galilee was the prime area. That's where the fishing and agriculture happened, and that's where most of the elites lived in the region around Galilee, because it was a very prosperous region. But down in Samaria, that was a place that the Jewish elite didn't particularly care for. The Samaritans were not the kinds of people that they wanted to associate with. And so geographically, where we are is that middle area, that liminal space between the privileged and the unprivileged. And that just happens to be where Jesus is. We can usually find Jesus in those liminal spaces with those people who are marginalized, with the common people who don't necessarily have the right access. Jesus did not fly first class. Let's get that straight. Jesus was probably more of a coach. In fact, truth be told, Jesus was probably more of a Greyhound bus type of traveler. But that doesn't quite work for my analogy, so we're going to just keep moving. But that's the region where Jesus is located. And then, not only do we have the geographic location, but to tell us that this is about privilege and priority, but we have the status of the individuals themselves. They are described as lepers. And if you know anything about the New Testament scriptures, you know that lepers were usually some of the most oppressed and underprivileged classes of people. Why is that? It wasn't necessarily leprosy like we know it. It was any kind of serious skin disorder that set you apart from people who were normal. Any kind of skin disorder could label you as a leper. And as a leper, it meant that you could not have jobs like other people. You could not have relationships like other people. You couldn't even hang out with your family like normal people. In fact, you had to keep your distance, which is what the text says, from everybody else, and you had to call out that you were unclean so that no one would come anywhere near you. Perhaps the biggest problem with being a leper, then, is not even being able to participate in normal life, not even having access to normal social relationships, being ostracized and treated as if you don't even belong within the community. But the lepers, recognizing who Jesus is, they keep their distance, but they still call out to him. This is their one chance. They ask for mercy. They know he's a healer. They know he can do some amazing things. And so they ask him for mercy. And Jesus is quick to respond. He doesn't even hesitate. In fact, Jesus literally speaks their healing into existence by just telling them to go to the priest because they were now healed. they complied. And as they were going, they realized that they had experienced this miraculous healing, and they continued on their way. But one of the ten, stopped in his tracks, turned back, thanked Jesus, and praised him. He actually became the embodiment of the kind of praise that Jesus appreciated by laying prostrate at Jesus' feet and giving glory to God for the healing that he had experienced. That a Samaritan, a foreigner, responded differently than all the others. I think that's something for us to examine this morning, is what that different kind of response means to us, what it suggests to us, and the kind of lesson it encourages us to take from this passage. You see, we know that in all of our various ways, at any time in our lives, we could be like these lepers. For some of us, it means that we are marginalized. For some of it means that we feel outcast, or we feel separated from those we love, or separated from access to the kinds of privileges that other people have. So maybe sometimes we feel marginalized. But then at other times, we are already being healed, we are already being brought back into society, and we appreciate the kind of blessing and the kind of life that we have and the kind of joy that we have just in receiving our daily bread, just in having jobs, just in having a family. We are appreciative of that. And in our appreciation, we go right on about our daily lives. We do this because God has already made us a priority. God makes us as Christians, as believers, a priority in creation, a priority in our world, and a priority in our communities. Think about it. God chose us. God chooses to love us. God chose us before we even knew who we were. What an extraordinary blessing. What an extraordinary amount of grace and mercy to have been chosen by God while we were yet sinners in the world. God chose us. God sent God's only Son so that we might experience salvation and that the world might come to know the saving grace of Jesus Christ. That we might inherit the realm of God that is yet to come. These are the blessings. These are the blessings that I dare say we don't think about very often. We are recipients of God's unending blessings, and while life may have its challenges, we know in our hearts that we are truly blessed. While life may have its challenges, we are blessed. The church is blessed with resources. The church is blessed with committed leadership. The church is blessed with committed memberships. Each of us under the sound of my voice, sitting right here, is blessed. If we examine our individual lives, our careers, our family, our friends, we have shelter, we have food, we have clothing, we are blessed. And beyond that, we know that we have hope in Jesus Christ, that at the end of the day, when all is said and done, we are promised a first-class seat in the kingdom that is to come. In other words, all of us were born first when the role was called. That's our sky priority line. But the text is also a challenge for us. The text also challenges us to think more deeply about our blessings, to think more deeply about our relationship to Jesus Christ, to think more deeply about how we are to respond to the blessings. Not everyone responds in the same way in the text to Jesus' healing. Not everyone responds in the same way to God's grace and we're honest with ourselves, we cannot blame them. What the lepers did is fairly normal. What they did is to be expected. After all, an argument could be made that they did exactly what Jesus told them to do. He said, go to the priest and show him. Think about it. They were socially ostracized. They were living in a society that did not value them. But this was their opportunity to get back in the game. And Jesus told them to do just that. The Levitical code said that if you had any kind of skin disorder, the only way you could get back into society, the only way you could get back into right relationships with each other, the only way that you could experience a normal life was to have the priest verify that you were no longer sick. So of course, they complied with what Jesus told them to do. Jesus knew that they wanted a normal life more than anything else, and Jesus gave that to them. We want a normal life more than anything else, and we have that. We know what that's like. We are promised an abundant life in Jesus, and there's nothing wrong with living that abundant life. There's nothing wrong with living in God's grace. There's nothing wrong with accepting and living under God's mercy. There's nothing wrong with wanting to have the normal life that we have been promised. But the one leper, the Samaritan, he knew that there was something more to life than just living a normal life. He knew that there was something more than just fitting in. He knew that there was something more that was at stake. This was a Samaritan. This was a leper. He had lived life in the back of a plane, back in row 45, in the middle seat. Or maybe at times he didn't even make it onto the plane. But he knew that the privilege that Jesus had just given him demanded something more of him. He knew more than just getting access to economy class or first class that he aspired to a different kind of priority. He had his sights set on a higher sky priority. Not one determined by the social structure, not one determined by what was normal part of society, but he aspired to a different kind of priority, and he set his sights higher than where the others did. Not just one of benefits, but one of loyalty, commitment, and even sacrifice. That's what he was called to. You see, as Christians, I dare say that if we're honest with ourselves, we sometimes forget what is really expected of us and what is asked. We receive God's blessings, we receive God's mercy, and we are to enjoy it and to live into it. But we must remember that there is something that comes along with this that all of us are asked to evaluate our lives and to take stock of where our commitments and where our priorities really lie. The Samaritan leper expressed his loyalty, not to the priest, not to society, not to getting back in the game, but he expressed his loyalty to the one who healed him and the one who saved him. He remained committed, even though the other lepers recognized Jesus and called out to him. They left as soon as they had the opportunity, but the Samaritan leper remained committed to what he believed in and stayed right there. The reality is this is an extraordinary sacrifice on behalf of this leper. He sacrificed being able to go back into his normal life to push for a deeper and stronger give ourselves back to the one who loved us before we even loved ourselves. Maybe the Samaritan was thinking of a different kind of sky priority. Maybe the Samaritan was thinking of a sky priority that is beyond anything that we can think of in our human situation. I'm reminded of the text from Colossians. The text from Colossians says this: "So if you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things that are above, not on things that are on earth, for you have died, your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you will also be revealed in him in glory." Sisters and my brothers, our faith calls us to a higher sky priority. It is heaven's desire for us that we live our lives in ways that embody the one who calls us into this life. It's not that we shouldn't focus on simply fitting in. We should be okay with fitting in. It's not that we shouldn't focus on community and positions. We should be okay with positions, but those are not the things that matter. We have a high calling in Jesus Christ that calls us to lay prostrate before the Lamb of God who gave his life for us. This is our sky priority. I'm also reminded of a text from Matthew. The text from Matthew 6 says this: "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust consume, where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust consume, where thieves do not break in and steal, for where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." The house we live in may be based on the money we make. The car we drive could be based on the bonuses that we receive, the clothes on our back we are able to afford because of our income. But none of this is as important as what we do for the kingdom. None of this is as important as what we do for those we are called to serve. Heaven has already given us our priorities. In Matthew 25, when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on the throne in glory and all the nations will be gathered before him. And he will ask, "What have we done?" Heaven is asking us right now, what are we doing? What are we doing with our hunger? What are we doing to make sure that every living person has access to clean water? What are we doing to make sure that we are welcoming strangers and not demonizing? What are we doing to rehabilitate persons who have committed crimes and bring them back into society? Heaven is watching us, y'all. Our faith calls us to a different kind of sky priority. There's one more thing that I'd like to share before I take my seat. It's almost a throwaway, but I need to call attention to it. It is not a coincidence that 1 in 10 of the lepers return. Did you catch that? 1 out of 10. Maybe I need to say it a little differently. It is not a coincidence that 10% return. 10%. Sometimes that's all it takes. The Samaritan leper was basically a tithe. What would it take for us to not just tithe, but to be a tithe? Amen. What would it take to commit ourselves just like the Samaritan leper, that no matter what everybody else does, we are going to give ourselves wholly and fully to the one who called us? We are going to give ourselves to the one who loves us. We are going to give ourselves to the one who calls from on high for us to make a difference in the world that we live in. Samaritan leper made a decision. He made a decision not to go back into the world and to try to live a normal life like everyone else. He made a decision to go back and to stand with the one who called him and the one who loved him. He made a different decision to deepen his faith, to deepen his connection to Jesus, to deepen his connection. Here's a text that I was given from Psalm 1. It says this: happy are those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or take the path that sinners tread, or sit in the seat of scoffers, but their delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law they meditate day and night. They are like trees planted by streams of water. The Samaritan leper decided plant himself by the stream that we call Jesus, because he knew that